Hello everyone, this is Finchinator here, and I'm going to be bringing you guys a bit of my own SPL cast of sorts. I don't know if you guys have seen, but Teda gave his own rendition of a bit of a SPL synopsis and his opinion as of the auction based on the NU players, and he tried to touch on some of the other ties which he wasn't too knowledgeable about, but he gave it a good effort, and AIM did a bit of a thing on the Wolfpack, which is the team he was drafted onto, and I figured I'd jump into it because it's Christmas, power rankings aren't out, people want something, and I'm pretty damn bored because I'm a Jewish boy sitting here home alone, so yeah, why not? So let's get into it. This is just a case victory post because he sort of got banned now, and that's funny. So nevertheless, let's jump into the rosters. And just going to have to readjust this. I'm sorry, this is some sort of unprofessional of me, but I'm not really professional at this. So, okay, there we go. So we got teams, Classiest, Ruiners, Biggs, Falcons, Scooters, Tigers, Chronicles, Sharks, and Raiders. Oh, and Wolfpack, sorry about that. Just in the order last year that they placed, in the order that they nominated an auction. So, I'm going to go only into the tiers of my expertise and then not really do much else on the other tiers, just because I don't want to be talking about things I don't know. Like, for example, asking me to speak about the doubles or the GSC players, it just wouldn't be fair because there's so many more knowledgeable people out there, and I only know very little, especially about a tier like doubles. that's better to ask someone like Mizuhimi, my assistant manager. Anyway, so getting into it, I'm going to highlight over the names of players and Swift tiers. The classiest, for ORAS OU, I'm going to cover ORAS OU, Black and White OU, and ORAS NU. Their overused players are Daftma 5 and Blunder. I have a little thing here. Let me pull it over. Can I pull it over? Yeah. You could see it sort of ranks the players. I have them being one of the weakest lineups in ORAS OU, but I don't necessarily think that's too indicative of them as the players. Let me get back into this. So I really think that both Blunder and Daphma 5, I'm sorry for mispronouncing Daphma 5, are really capable players, especially ones that are ranked lower in my little rankings that I assembled myself. But I just think that Blunder, I'm not sure if he's necessarily proven without the help of someone like Hugo. And I know that he's capable. I've seen his YouTube videos and his playing tournaments on the ladder, etc. And he's good. He's ranked 16th out of 20, which isn't bad, especially given the player pool. But yeah, and Daft, he doesn't really have much proven to him. I think that he could maybe even be a rank or two higher, but there are a lot of good players. He's the lower rank, so that's something else. So I think that these guys will probably pull out more wins than someone that you'd expect the 16th and 20th to be. But as of now, neither of them has any successful SPL winning experience in OU tire. Daft doesn't have any SPL experience at all. You could see why they're lower ranked. It's sort of harsh to rank them as low as I did, but it just sort of panned out that way given the volume of other players. And okay, now let's go into the Ruiners. They have interesting. They've got ABR, and they have I believe their other OU player is the Ender. Yeah, there he is, Ender. And this is interesting because both of these guys are known for their building a bit more than their playing. Specifically, ABR, who has been building all over the place. He's created that old stall team that's now been, after a lot of controversy, been sort of nerfed by the ban. He's been all over the building scene and all over the OLT scene. So he's a very good up-and-coming player. But he doesn't have experience in SPL. In fact, his only tour game experience has been in OLT. So you've got to keep an eye out for his plays. He's had a couple games where he's made some decisions. I'm a big fan of his, don't get me wrong. But he's not the best player out there quite yet. But he has potential to be one of, if not the best player in this pool. So I have high expectations for him. But I wouldn't be too totally shocked if they weren't met. And then Ender, he did well last SPL after being bought midseason by my team last year to Biggs. And he did well in World Cup on East. So I'm finding good things about him. But the one thing that is to mention is that he is rusty. He hasn't played ORAS since World Cup. So you kind of got to take that for what it is. It could hurt him. It could not hurt him at all. He could bounce back very strong. He could bounce back pretty weak. So two players that are strong but have question marks. If you go back to my rankings, you'd see that they're the third core. I have Ender ranked 9th and ABR ranked 4th. And I think that's fair placement for both of them. Oh, I'm just going to avoid that. Yep. ABR, I feel like it's worth noting that he will always be prepared for opponents. He is very tedious with his preparation. He even makes it tedious for himself. He finds log, he finds replay, he builds teams in the other builder. He goes through his own sort of preparation. He knows what he wants to use. So he will never be underprepared. But if someone is versatile and is his opponent, I'm going to wonder how he's going to sort of confront that, because he hasn't faced too many versatile players in OLT. And I think that he'll encounter something different in SPL. So I feel like this is a different environment from him, so he's new. So it really depends how he's going to handle it. So that's why he's not ranked, let's say, second or third, but someone who's a bit more seasoned, like TDK and CB is ranked second or third, respectively. And also, Ender. Last year, Ender, I think he probably would have been ranked like one or two more up had he been net form, but he's not, so he's ranked below the others. And I'll get into that in a bit. Anyway, third is the Bigs, my team from last year. And I really love my team, don't get me wrong. But I didn't rank our players the highest simply because if you look at things and how they are and experience, etc., just playing familiarity with the tournament community, neither of these guys are known as top OU players. Remedy was ranked very high last year. He had a bit of a disappointing SPL, but he showed last year, in this year in World Cup, that he's very capable of winning in the tire. And his builds historically, even last year when he was losing a couple games, always really struck me as very knowledgeable, intuitive, and prepared for opponents. So I said high things for Remedy. I've ranked him 10th, which is right in the middle of the pack. Here you could I'll flash that in the screen again. I'll just leave that here for a second. You can see he's 10th. And you can see him probably is ranked 18th. He went 3-1 in the World Cup, which was good for him. But he did only use the Fable in his 3 wins. And it's worth noting that he, outside of World Cup playing for US Central and winning what was called the Bracket of Death after facing AIM, Heist, and he was going to face some Brazilian dude. I forget who. Adam, but then he ended up facing Spedo, and he beat Spedo. Spedo choked on fucking dicks, but that's besides the point. And so he's only ranked 18th just because he hasn't been in SPL before. He hasn't really proven himself. He did almost make Smogon playoffs 1 year, but he didn't quite come out. He came up quite a bit short. And so yeah, it's hard to rank them that high. So that's why he's sort of bringing them down a bit. The core Remedy's in the middle of the pack. So they're 7th out of 10, and I still really see a lot of potential in these guys. They're on my team, so I'm not going to try to hype them up too much. They don't want to be all biased and shit, but I think both of these guys have potential to do well in this tier. And they can help each other out, and they're both good builders, and they're both strong players, so we'll see. But the thing is, that's a running trend, because all of these people that make it to this point are strong players. So I don't necessarily know, you're saying, oh, you're good, if that's good enough. Because you've got to be able to really understand the game and understand the metagame, how to build and how to prepare, and what you're going to expect to really be successful. It's a bit beyond just being, oh, I know how to play Pokemon, because that's not going to get you too far here. On to the Falcons. They have a nice, interesting core. They have two people. Dasung, who's really just been winning everything. He's won 2 target Smogon tours out of the last 3, and did well last SPL. He had a shaky World Cup, but that doesn't seem to be his tournament over the last 2 years, really. So barring that, Dasung has done well across the board. He's my number one ranked OU player, and I think he's probably the number one ranked for pretty much everyone. And then they've got Destiny Device. I'm just going to highlight the name. It's a song. And Destiny Device. Destiny Device, an interesting case. See, he had a lot of hype going in last SPL, and then he did pretty well after struggling a bit. He ended up with like a 6-3 or 6-4 record, I think. I think let's go with 6-3. I think that was it. Correct me if I'm wrong, but so he's solid, but I don't think he's held on to it, because I've heard he's been playing League of Legends a lot lately, and he had a bit of a weak World Cup. I think he went 1-2. It was only his win where he hacks the shit out of Sam being a UU player who he did well in OU, so I'll give him that. So it was a quality loss, but he really lost to Weakar, he lost to Darren, so you got to question that. And he hasn't really been too active since World Cup, but he just said he was coming back for SPL, and he has came back. So I didn't rank him too high. I ranked him 14th. I'm just going to leave this here. And So they're the 5th. It's just a bit above average. It's the song being 1st and Destiny Device being 14th out of 20. I would like to note that I think Tsung could help DD, especially if he's active. I know he's on vacation now, but he'll be back come time for the season. So I could really respect that. And so I think the Falcons have a chance to do well, especially if DD shakes off the rust and goes back to his winning ways from before World Cup. So I like what they have going. I think it has potential, but it's not quite there yet to be one of the top rosters. Getting into Scooters, they have the German OU players. They've got X-Ray and Cosine, respectively. I'm just going to highlight them. And Goten is in the middle of them, so I guess he's getting packaged in. Goten got failed up by BKC, and they're not going to fucking use him. It's pretty funny, but that's besides the point. So they've got X-Ray and Cosine, and I really like both of these guys. I really, really do. I just want to say that X-Ray, he's almost went under the radar, 10K retained. He's a really good builder. His battling skills are are not on top of the competition. Like, he's not as good as Tsung, I'd say. But he's up there, and he's doing well, and he'll continue to do well. I could see him putting up a 5-4, 6-3. I don't think he'll dominate, but I think that he's able to prepare. I think he'll do well. He's just got to keep his mentality up, and he's got to play to his best of his ability, and he'll be fine. Callsign, he's been sort of branded as a top three OUer as of the last couple months after he dominated Smogon Tour, and he did well in the World Cup. So, yeah, he's been seen as up there. But as of since the middle of OLT, he's sort of been falling back off. He hasn't necessarily been putting in 100% effort. He's been using the same kind of stuff. So I sort of question the legitimacy of him being claimed as a top OU player. Like, I know PDC went off on him in some cast beforehand. The pre-auction SPL cast, which was a fucking joke, by the way. But anyway, I think Callsign, if he is a bit more versatile and he puts some effort into it and really plans things out, he's capable of being a top 5 player. I have him ranked at numbers 5 and then X-Ray at number 6. So, yeah, these guys pan out as the second best OU lineup, which is respectable. The German core for the Scooters. So, yeah, both of these guys, I feel like, could be hit or miss, but they have a much likelier chance of being hit than miss. I think Cosine is just a matter of putting in effort and preparation and being versatile. And I think X-Ray is just a matter of thinking through everything clearly and playing at a optimal level, because you know that his teams will be on point. He's a very good builder. Excuse me. Tigers, okay. Now the Tigers started off the auction by getting not only Bemge but also Great in the first two bids. And Bemge was fairly cheap; he was only 7.5k, I believe. And Great was like 10.5. But the thing is that Great sort of trolled the fuck out of what I was going to get him. See, he didn't actually have any intention of playing, and that really screwed them over quite badly, to be honest. They did get a pick. This is not updated, but they have Asuya now, and they have money, more credits for midseason. They don't have Great anymore. Great is tournament banned and banned from SPL for life. But their two OU players are Ben Gay and Mensmeat. Yeah, Mensmeat. There you go. I think Great was going to play black and white anyway, but he still could have helped out a lot with teams and shit if he was at full form. So I'm sort of annoyed at him just because why would the fuck would you sign up? Like, it's not my team. And if anything, it helps my team because they wasted their money in the auction, but why the fuck would you sign up if you had no intention of playing? That is so immature of you. Like, I know you're one of the more revered players, historically speaking, but come on, man, that's bull. And I feel bad for the Tigers, especially Sweep, who's a very nice guy, and there's his manager in tennis, who's their manager, and I feel bad for the team. But they still have some ground that they have covered in the auction in terms of picking ORAS players. Ben Gay is solid last year. He does have a bit of an issue when it comes to playing in tough games, as you can see in his game against Staticus in the World Cup. But I know that he is capable. He's done well in the past. He's won some games. So he's sort of a middle-of-the-line player. I have him ranked 12th because he sort of quit after the World Cup and just sort of disappeared. Fell off of the council and everything. So I guess he's sort of like Ender in a sense, except Ender I rank a bit higher because he's a bit more practical with the teams. Bengay's teams are great, don't get me wrong, but they're sort of innovative and they could backfire at a sense. You could use shit like Mega Camera, which could be good or could be quite bad. So yeah, I'm just sort of, it's a bit more risky. I think Bengay has a very high upside though. He could finish off a top 5 player, he could finish off a bottom 5 player, he's really across the board. So that's why I rank them in the middle. And then Mensmeat I have right behind him. Mensmeat done really well historically. Don't get me wrong, I'm just going to scroll this up. But yeah, oh, there we go. Mensmeat's done really well historically, but the thing is, he's always had the help of Great or someone on Team UK, I guess, to build teams for him. Or Team Metro, I don't remember what he's played on World Cup. Besides the point, he's always had the help of someone to build teams. And I just wonder if Ben Gale will be able to pump out teams for him, or if he'll still get teams from Great, although Great quit that team. I don't think he'll get teams from Hugo, but it's sort of an awkward note, and I'm just wondering on the ability of him to be self-sufficient. I know he's a capable player. If I was just ranking the playing ability, he'd be top 10. He's able to win games. He's done well in the past. He's done that. He's not a ghosting slot or anything. He's certainly not. But I just question his ability to team build and prepare by himself. So that's why he's ranked 13th. He could easily be a couple up, but if he's not able to do that, he could easily go a couple down. Okay, next off. We got the Cryonicles, Cryonicles, what the fuck? I've never pronounced that name, to be honest. I've never even thought of how it would be said. But we're at them, so that's their team. Their ORAS players are Alexander and G-Mick. I'm gonna call him G-Mick. Okay, so G-Mick, I've heard a lot of good things about, actually. G-Mick all these French guys that's to say is super good at building. He was in the big plans at one point. He sort of would have been if he was cheaper and we didn't get him Probable and Remedy. So yeah, but he's a good player and good builder, but he doesn't have the experience outside of World Cup, and we sort of question if he could win games independently at this level. So that's why he's not ranked too high. And Alexander's been doing very well in OLT, but again, the competition there isn't too good, although he's beaten a good player too, like Shake. But I just wonder if he could use things that aren't offensive, and I wonder if he's playing by himself. And the Italian general sentiment is sort of spooky, if you know what I mean. So I'm not willing to rank him too high. If we go back to my little paste bin that we got here, you'll see he's ranked 11th, which is between Bengay and Remedy, which is, I think, a respectable placement, given his accomplishments so far. And Gimmick is ranked 19th, which is sort of a discredit to him, I'm not going to lie. But again, the whole player pool is pretty respectable, so I wouldn't take that as a shame, per se. I just think he's going to have to work a bit harder to win games this level, because I think his building is there, but I don't know if he could prepare necessarily too well. Just building in general is there, and I don't know if he could play at that level quite yet. I think that he's worth a bit less than he was, like 10K, for crying out loud. So yeah, it's not a bad OU pool. I just ranked it 8th. It could easily be 6th or 7th. It's just a lot of good players in OU if you think about it. So yeah, I respect both these guys, but they're not ranked too high, if you know what I mean. Anyway, so next team is the Sharks. They've got Riku, okay, and Steve Angelo. Riku did very well in World Cup, but he sort of fell out of the scene since then. I haven't really seen him around much. He played POCL. He was actually really active then, but he didn't really have too much motivation to play OU. I think he's a very capable player, though. Like, I think that him being ranked 17th is fucking crazy, but like, I was piecing the ranks together. I'm like, okay, I can't really put him above him, so I guess I gotta slap him here. But he could definitely win games. It's just a matter of him playing to the fullest potential that he had played out, like he did in World Cup when he beat Sam and went like 5 or 6-1, I think. Yeah, let's go with that. So and there's also Steve Angelo, who there's no Uber, so he's going to definitely be an OU player this year, but he's perfectly capable. He's done well in World Cup, and he even played a little bit in last SPL. So, yeah, he's ranked 15th, which is a lower middle of the pack. He could be up a bit more, but I think that putting him in front of someone like Mincemeat or Destiny Device, who only play OU, and have done it successfully in the past, would be hard. So I think that's why I slapped him above sort of the people that are unproven in SPL, like Blender and Rico, though Rico's proven in World Cup, and Blender is proven sort of in general, just played a lot. And But below the people that have been proven in SBL that are sort of rusty. So I think that's a good middle ground, 15th for Steven Angelo. But he can do well. He's got to work on his temperament a bit, but they took that risk in getting him, and I think that that's respectable. They've also got CTC on the bench, but I'll get into bench players in general ratings later. I'm just going through their teams and their players in a tie right now. This is going to be a long-ass thing, so get your popcorn ready if you haven't already. And you're still listening to me ramble on and on and on and on and on and on. So yeah, next team up, the Raiders. Now, these guys have, in my opinion, the best OU core. They've got two top three players, for Christ's sake. They've got the Dragon Knight, TDK, the best builder, the builder of East teams, whatever the fuck you want to call him. The guy who's like 45% of Hugo. He's quite good at building. He's good at playing the game as well. I feel like he's got a bit to prove, because last SPL he lost to Prankster. And he lost a game or two in World Cup, but although his game against the Scavalier, he sort of really couldn't do much about it. He played very well, so I'm certainly not discrediting him as a player. I think he's a very good player. That's why I have him ranked 2nd behind the Song. But at the same time, he still could show us all, yeah, he's legitimate, just as good as his building as was his playing. So yeah, then there's CBB, who's an offensive real bull in his tire, and he's built a fuck ton of teams. He just hasn't like played in an SPL or a World Cup in the last 2 years. He's sort of been sitting around managing, helping Team Germany, etc. So both of these guys have potential to be a number one, but they're still ranked 2 and 3, and the Sung has just achieved all of these levels of number one, so I think that's respectable. But this is the best OU core if you're going to generate the most wins, but I think that both of them have small question marks, so that's why they're not ranked first. But I expect good things. CDK, CBB, both good builders, both good players. CB a bit more proven playing. TK a bit more proven building. Both of them been around. Both of them know to tire. So, yeah. And the last OU lineup is the Wi-Fi Wolfpack. This is interesting because they've got AIM, PDC, Omfuga, Stathicus, Cicada, Flaming Victini, Badading, Laurel, Sugarkai. All could play ORAS OU. I don't know if Badabing could, but besides that, all of those guys could play ORAS OU if you think about it. But I think that they're going to go with the strongest two being AIM and PDC. Both of them are East players. They've got that synergy going. AIM could potentially drop to lower tier, but I don't think that's going to happen given their lineup. But I like them both. I think Flame 15 is going to help a lot with building teams. He's got some unconventional stuff. He's even got an RMT out there that was nice. Sort of a bit stally, but nice. Just a bit not my style, but I've seen it been used successfully. And maybe even Laurel, because Laurel does put effort in to help his team win, and you can respect that a lot. So, yeah, it's an interesting lineup. Both of them are East, and they're ranked 7th and 8th overall, and this is my 4th combined lineup, as you see. So now we're going to go just overall analysis. I'm going to explain why I put people where. So let's get back to TDK and CBB. So both of them are really good players, as I said. Not quite number one individually, but if you combine them in tangent with each other, they're the best OU lineup. Now let's look at the Raiders. Oh, fuck. Oops-a-daisy. there we go. Let's look at the Raiders. Support. TDK building teams is really just enough to support any team, to be honest. But CBB also builds a lot of teams. And then Hack actually knows a bit of ORAS OU. I know he was learning it a couple months back, so maybe he could help. He's just a generally good tester. I think he's going to be in the bench week one, unless he gets a spot starting like LC, NU, or RBY. He's going to be a very helpful teammate, in my opinion. He's a great guy, Hack. Other than that, they don't have much support in ORAS OU, but I don't think they need it with that lineup, so I that justifies the number one ranking, just having TDK and CBB. They spent like 15k for TDK after the retain. They spent 24k for CBB, so it's almost a combined 40k, 39k on their ORAS OU. So yeah, hell yeah, they better be good. Okay, anyway, now you've got the Scooters. I'm just going to scroll this back in again. This is sort of sloppy, I know. But you've got Cosine being 5th, X-Ray being 6th. The Scooters, outside of having Cosine and X-Ray row you, they've got Aureus, a third German to help them out. So they're really going hard on the Germans. Jesus. And Jirachi and BKC both know ORAS OU to some extent, so they could help out. And even Brofist, who played on World Cup for East. So, yeah, I think that they have a lot of potential to do well in ORAS OU, especially if they work together as a group. So I could respect that ORAS OU lineup, and they're definitely justifiably second. Third lineup, the Ruiners, they've got ABR and the Ender. And this is sort of a hit or miss lineup, as I said, you can see. ABR is ranked 4th, and Ender is ranked 9th. And ABR, as a player, is really still unproven, as I said. As a builder, he's great. And he's made some strides as a player in OLT. He's beaten some good players. He's beaten some bad players. He's lost to Shake once. And he even lost that one game the Fox got. I was like, holy fuck, you're going to kill me after watching that game. After watching that series, really. But I think that if the Rust goes off Ender and ABR can handle the pressure, the increased preparation, the level of play at this level, then these guys could even be a number one or a number two lineup. But with those ifs, it drops them down to number three, because there's a lot of things that can go wrong. But there are a lot of things that can go wrong for everyone, really. So who knows? But I think the Ruiners have it going, and honestly, I think they've really got a lot of potential. Fourth, we got the Wolfpack. Their last teams, I'm not going to go back to this. You saw PDC was 7, AIM was 8. They've got an East core, and I'd actually like to note that I went out of my way to make it PDC, AIM, Ender in a row, because I feel like all these guys are comparable skill levels. They all played on East together. They're all above average players, but they're not all quite top. They all, PDC and AIM, I think, are a bit better than Ender playing-wise, especially since they're a bit less rusty. But I think Ender is the best builder of the three. But Ender's paired with ABR, so I think that their teams are just going to be spectacular, especially if Ender and ABR get along well. But I think PDC and AIM, with the help of their roster, cause as I went into before, they've got PDC, AIM, Cicada, Flame Victini, Laurel, Sugar High. They're still going to be able to pump out good teams, and they've got the good players. It's just a matter of PDC not being too one-dimensional, and AIM playing to his fullest potential, and not having his router disconnected, if you know what I mean. So, yeah, I think that they're a good four. I think it's a very strong four. Then I think there's a bit of a gap between 4 and 5. You get to the Falcons with Tsung and DD, and now you sort of notice, like, every single player in the 1 through 4 team was top 9. Then you drop down where there's a 1 and a 14. So you got Tsung, who's just got all that going for him. He's the best player. in this tire, in my opinion, right now. You can respect that. Then he's got DD, and DD, I think that I'd like to say that he's a worry. Like, the bigs weren't sure if we wanted to pursue him or not. I think we up at him once. We really loved working with him last year, but he's played a lot of league lately. He's sort of been slacking. He's been too active in the Pokemon community. So I've got to wonder if he's going to be able to bring it together to an SPL level or not this season. So that's why he's ranked 14th, and he's got a really high ceiling. See, that's a big, big, big question mark for the Falcons and OU. However, I'm looking at their lineup. They do have Dice, who's done well in World Cup. He's able to help in OU. I feel like Ray Scarface maybe a bit too, but I'm not sure. TRC definitely knows OU stuff. I think he's been on QC and stuff, as does Lefties. Lefties are a great OU builder, good OU player. So I think that if they get a good team synergy going, then they're able to help each other. So also Ari, how could I forget? Yeah, Ari, the World Cup wonder. I think Ari isn't really ready to start at SPL level, you know, management, but he's got some good teams. He's done well sometimes. So we'll see. But I feel like they've got good support, and they've got one great 100% going to be a hit this SPL player. They've got one big question mark, and I don't think their subs will do much better. So that's why they rank 5th, because they've got one sure good player, and then they've got one. So it's where you get into the middle of the pack. Then you've got the Tigers with Ben Gay and Mincemeat. Both these guys going to have some rust. Both these guys going to have some flaws in terms of Ben Gay, really. I'm not sure if he could still function playing this game at such a great level after World Cup and then taking like 6 months off in Mincemeat after being rusty in general. He doesn't have team building either. So I feel like if they could help complete each other, like Ben Gay could become a better player through learning through Mincemeat and stuff. Or it just like really solidifies old skills and shake off the rust. And Mincemeat could become a better builder, have better teams through it than Gay. I feel like they could really be a complete group. But right now they've got still those voids there. So I don't know if that'll work out. And they've also worth noting that help from Ladybug, who I guess knows some ORAS OU. I don't know how he's been helping out or what he knows. And a Scavalier, who's really shown me a lot of potential in his World Cup stint. I think he went 3-0 or 4-0 or 3-1 or something like that. But yeah, he's solid. It's like, yeah, honorable mention to Trekking, who's a solid ORAS OU player, but he's gotten teams from Italy. He doesn't really build that tire, I don't think. And he's probably going to be playing LC, so yeah. They've got the table set for ORAS OU, but they've got to put dinner on it, and they've got to make dinner well. And it's just a matter of really executing there. You know, you've got to not burn it. You got to not make it too cold. So you got to make the dinner the right way. You got to play the game the right way, if you catch my drift. Next off, we got my bigs. I'm going to try to hold off on this, but I feel like player-wise, Remedy and Improbable are both a bit underrated, a bit unknown. Remedy underrated mainly because he didn't do too as well as he could have last SPL. He bounced back in World Cup. Improbable mainly because he hasn't really played in an SPL before. But if you also look at the support, you've got Bodush, you've got me, Finchinator, you've got McMegan, you've got Zoro Dark, Metal Gross, and Donut. We've got a fuck ton of ORAS OU support. We've got a lot of versatile players. So I think we're going to be able to pull a lot of wins. We're going to prepare well, and we're going to try hard enough. So I think that that 7th with Remedy being 10th and probably being 18th is just not an accurate depiction. But at the same time, it could really go anyway. So we'll have to see. 8th, we've got the Cryonicles, whatever the fuck you say their name like. You tell me because I've given up at this point. You got Alexander and Gimmick, whatever the fuck. I'm bad at pronouncing people on the scene. That's my determination. 11th and 19th, respectively. Gimmick can build teams. Alexander's sort of spooky, but he can pump out offensive teams. He can play. Both these guys just have to prove that they can play at this SPL level because neither has played in an SPL before. And then if they do as well as they have in other tournaments or even close to that as they have in this and just show that, then I think they could easily go up to 6th or 7th. So yes, they're 8th, but they're not a weak 8. They're not a weak 8 at all. They're a very strong 8. Now you get a sort of another jump. You get Riku and Steven Angelo at 9th. I'm just not too confident in either of their abilities to consistently win at this level, given that Steve, I don't know how much OU he's played, and Riku, I don't know how much OU he's played either recently, but both these guys have done well in the past, with Riku only being in World Cup and Steve Angelo mainly being in SPL, but if they could really play their full potential, they could do well, and if not, then it's gonna be dark for the Sharks. Support-wise, they have Blarigin, who really can play any tire, I feel, so he's always good to have on a team. They've got CTC, who's probably gonna be pretty sporadic in the activity department. We could build teams, I guess, if they're not like fucking Hita Fajita bullshit. Marth, I don't know if he plays any ORAS anymore, but he's cool. Smurf, he's active, but his time zone's kind of weird, and Alistair Law, he's a Spanish dude, he could build, he's okay. I was surprised when he got bought, to be honest. I don't think he's SPL level, but that's just me, I guess. sorry about that. Just a bit of a cough, and I'll shake your throat. Then you got Blunder and Daphmoth 5. I've wanted these guys. They've got they do have support. They have Jinji and Zamrock. I think that both these guys, Jinji, Zamrock, Daphmoth, and Blunder, all of them would be lower end starters, to be honest. I think that's respectable. And they also have Ojama, who's cool, a bit spooky, but he's cool, and Anti and Shake. So they've got support in the OE department. I'm not doubting that. I just don't think that they have the all of the skills and experience and winning ability in SPL right there now. But I think they can develop that easily, especially if Shake and Anti manage the team well. So that goes it for ORAS OU. I really feel like there's a lot of chances for pretty much every team to do well here. It's sort of a new fresh start for some teams, and sort of developing, building on a tradition of having strong OUers for others. And I feel like the Raiders, Scooters, Ruiners, and Wolfpack top four. Then you get sort of a fallback. Then you get Falcons, Tigers, Bigs, Cryos. Maybe not Cryos. Maybe Falcons, Tigers, Bigs, then a bit of a fall. Then Cryos, Sharks, Classiest. But overall, I don't see much negative things to say about them. So now I'm going to pause this for 1 second, and then I'm going to speak about the black and white OU players. Hello. Okay. Finch back once more. Now we're doing black and white OU, and this is where I play, so yay. anyway, the players are going to be Solowin, Sweepage, Lefties, Marth, Peachy, Jirachi, myself, Evewelf, Ryan, Taha, Luck Over Skill, and Asuya or Tokyo Tom. I'm not really sure. I guess I'll find out when the power rankings come out. Both of them can play, but it also happens to be the order that I rank them. I'm going to get into that. So Solowin, really fucking good player. He knows his shit in black-white. He showed that last season he did very well. He also did pretty well the season before. Pardon that noise, just me slipping in my chair. So, not really surprised to see him ranked 1. I have high hopes for him, but he's still got to execute to do well. I know I'll certainly give him a run for my money, and I'll certainly give others a run for my money, too. Next off, we got Sweepage. Sweepage never really done well in a team tournament, but he's always done well on tour and shit. So I have high hopes for him. He knows the stuff in black and white. He might be seen as a bit one-dimensional because he uses a lot of bulky sands. But, I mean, who doesn't use a lot of fucking bulky sands in black and white, especially when you get to this level play? It's just so reliable, fallbackable. So I feel. So I also think he can mix it up a bit. So he's ranked 2nd. Then Lefties at 3rd. And Lefties has a really fucking high ceiling. And the more I think about it, Lefties' building is amazing, spectacular. I wish I was a fucking builder like him. Like, holy crap. He is great in that department. But when it comes to push to shove, in World Cup, and especially in SBL, he's never really been successful. I question his modes of preparation. I don't know if he just brings shit he likes, or if he just sort of randomizes the teams that he brings, or if there's some method to his madness he prepares for opponents. But prime example was, in World Cup, he lost to Carlu, or whatever his name is, and Carlu used a team that was literally the first team in his fucking replays, and that's throwing away a game. You should 100% be prepared for that, you know, should set to that, etc. So I really feel like he'd be a 1 or a 2 if he prepared and if he was proven to do well in SPL. But he still has such a high ceiling, he's still such a good player and builder. He's always had my number in the past. I can't really remember a time when I've consistently been able to beat Lefties. I beat him once or twice here and there, but he always beats me otherwise. He's got a very good record against me as a player. So I respect him, and I rank him 3rd. Some could say that it's a bit high, given his track record in SBL and World Cup, which I went into before, but I think that's a fair placement for him. And I think he's also got support in the Falcons. I get into support after I talk about players, so anyway, let's get to the next player, Marth. Marth has always done well in SBLs, to my knowledge. I think he might have been a bit rusty, but I saw him playing a lot on Smog Tours lately, and I think he's winning a lot of games there too. So I don't know Marth personally. I don't think he really likes me for whatever reason, but good player. Respectable. 4th in black-white. I think that's where he belongs. 4th, 5th. Peachy is sort of a question mark to me. Peachy's done well in the past. I don't think she's really ever putting up that bad of a record. She's been helpful for her team. She's been a good player, strong player. But I don't know how fond she is of the Wolfpack this year. I think she's okay with it because on nails and stuff. So she's got some support. She's got a nice ability. But I don't know how much she likes the new black and white either. So that's a question mark. If she adjusts to them at a game, she likes her team, she tries hard, then she could be a 2nd or 3rd or even the 1st player. She's very capable. But given all the question marks, and she also hasn't played in the World Cup, she hasn't played since last SPL in a big tournament, besides the smogon tour season in the middle, you gotta wonder if Peachy still has it all together, and if Peachy's adjusted, and if Peachy's ready to really fire on all cylinders and do well at this level. So that's why she's middle of the pack instead of top of the pack. Next off, you got Jirachi. Jirachi, oh my god, this guy is great at black and white. I gotta say, I worked with him last year, and I was amazed by his knowledge, his team-building ability, and his playing. But he's still got some kinks to work out of his stuff. He's got to branch out a bit and not use as much Alakazam sand. But, I mean, you could say that for, like, half the players. But really, like, I noticed some distinct trends. Like, I had a team that I built for him for World Cup that would have beaten... Well, it would have had a massive advantage against literally 9 out of the 10 teams he used in SPL. Well, no, like 7 out of the 8 teams he used in SPL in black and white. When he played 2 games in EPP, 10 games total. So, yeah, you just got to wonder if he's able to mix it up and if he's able to sort of do his best and counter the competition while building solid teams and playing at a high level. It's just sort of a lot of elements that come into it. And last year he did well, but outside of last year, Jirachi's never really been too successful in black and white. So I hate to be a critic because he's my good friend, and I'm really proud that he did well last year, and I'm really looking forward to him doing well this year. But it would be a bit of a stretch to rank him much higher just because all of the players above him are either lefties or have done well in the past, and I already went into how lefties. I'm really a big fan of lefties. So, yeah. Me, I'm next. What can I say? I really think that I'm going to try harder than most of these guys. Not that they're not going to try hard, but I'm just a fucking try hard as fuck. So there you go. And I really like black and white. I think I'm building well. I think I'm playing well. But I do not have any experience in World Cup. Where I went 2-2, but I should have been 4-0. Fuck Stone Edge. Yeah, I'm salty. Fuck you, Light Chew. You gotta kill yourself. Not really, though. I don't really feel that personally bad about it. But it makes a good meme, so why not? But... Yeah, if I could throw rocks accurately, if I don't have blind mons, then I think I'll get my wins. But it would be hard to rank me above any of the players above me, so 7th is where I'd reside, and that is fine. Yeah, Evewolf is next. Evu is unproven. He played one game last year, lost to Remedy, but let me tell you, with working this guy last year, he played Ubers, but he was on the bigs, and he talked a lot about black and white. This guy's really fucking knowledgeable. He won 2 black and white smog tours in a row at one point. I have so much respect for Evewolf as a player. He's very good. He's very capable of winning. I just don't know if he'll be able to diversify his playstyle much. And I don't know if he'll be able to prepare much. I don't know how much effort he's willing to put in. I don't know how well he gets along with Ojama. And I don't think he wants to be a ghosting slot. So there might be some tension there because Ojama. But. If Evewolf gets that all going, he's going to win some games. Let me tell you, he is the strongest number 8 I've seen in my goddamn life. Like... There were some strong low-ranked players in RSU, but this guy is really good. I love Evewolf, so I'm looking forward to big things, but I can't really rank him much higher justifiably at this point. Luck is 9th. He's going to be my week 1 opponent, so he's going to start out 0-1, unfortunately, for him. Sorry, Luck. But he used to be pretty good, I think. I felt like he's done well in a couple tournaments, World Cup-wise. He hasn't really done well in SPL yet. He's never really done well in Black White or UNSPL. He went like 1-3 in his one stint in it, so... You gotta be worried there. Now let's get into the team and the support and shit. Class C, yes. Evewolf obviously has Ojama help. I don't know how much Kana is familiar with black and white, but he could probably help too. And then you got Zamrock and Blunder. They both know a bit of black and white. And Blunder actually played a game of black and white last year against Vince, and if he didn't get hacked, he probably would have won. So he's got some support. He's not gonna be shy, I hope. If he's shy, then that might sort of deteriorate that affected the support, but if he's able to get along with his team and talk a lot and build and prepare well, then he's going to do well and he's going to get some support, blah, 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 blah. I went into this before, but yeah, he's got the classics have a good suited team for black white. Ruiners. Okay, why am I saying that? I don't know. Okay, someone doesn't really need support, but I mean, like, IFM knows black white, although I don't know how Axel Beaks has got like cheerleading and shit. Disenchanted at least knows a bit, and as does Luigi. Luigi's a really underrated mess of support, by the way. I don't think I mentioned him under the ORAS support, but Luigi knows his black, white, his ORAS, and even his DVP, so I can really respect them. They've also got a bit of a Brazilian core going, so yeah. I like what the Alpha Ruiners have going with their OU and their team synergy, and I think that Solomon's going to rack up a lot of wins, and I'm good for them, good for him, but I'm going to beat him. So we got the bigs, we got Mina. Let's count all the capable black and white players in this roster. Funkasaurus, Bodouche, Finchinator, McMegan, Lamedy, Malekith, Metal Gross, Zoro Dark, and Well, improbable sort of too. So yeah, and we've got a lot of fucking black and white support, and I've already been testing with like all these guys, playing so many games. I'm so excited to work with all these guys, and I'm just giddy right now. If you saw my face, I've got a big smile on my face, and a lot of big help in black and white. A lot of big ideas in black and white. I've already got some preparation going and everything, and I think that I'll be able to do well in this environment. But that's just me speaking, and obviously I'm gonna toot my own damn horn. So we'll see. Oh, fuck. Oops. Wait. Oh, this is awkward. Okay. That's there. And now, there we go. Wait. Okay, there we go. Okay. Sorry about that. Now, after the bigs, we got the Falcons, the Firebot Falcons. They've got lefties in black white, but they've got help from DeSong, they've got help from Ray Scarface, Dice, even Zoroark Forever, who's admittedly pretty good at black and white. I played him a couple times. I like the guy. He'll be the LCA, but he's cool. And but I feel like they're going to do well in black and white. So that's why I left his big third. He's got a bit of a different environment. Like, I don't think he could prosper last year in the Raiders environment. I don't think the Afrobs were too welcome to him. And he didn't do well in either of those teams in the team tournaments. But now that they've got the support, I think Lefty's going to really flourish. And if he doesn't, then maybe he's just not meant for team tours. But I'm going out on a limb and rank him third. So let's hope for the best. Next off, we got the Scooters. We got Jirachi playing it with the help of BKC, the help of Gengar, a.k.a. Brofist, or John, whatever the fuck you want to call him. He's a cool dude. And you got, I guess, Liberty 32 and Floppy could help it, and Cosine could help it in Black White 2. So, yeah, they've got support, and Jirachi really does it all. And he, whenever he needs help, he can ask me as well. So, yeah, they're strong, Black White. It's just hard to rank Jirachi much higher, given the circumstances I described before. And, yeah, Tigers, sort of a mess in black white, not gonna lie. Support wise, tough, I don't think so. Sapienti, I don't think so. Tokyo Tom, good guy, I don't know how active he's gonna be, but he's gonna help. Ladybug, maybe, but sort of gimmicky and not really best support. Mentioned that question his activity and a black white ability, to be honest. Jabba, maybe, could help, I don't know, but really, Asuya, Tokyo Tom, whichever one of them play black white, kind of gonna be on their own, and I don't think they're really good enough to handle the pressures of being an SPL black white on their own. I don't think Asui is, given what I know about him. So, very low expectations. Like, lower than the last in ORAS, if you want to compare the two. Next off, we got the Cryonicles, or whatever the fuck, how do you pronounce that name? Yeah, as we said, they got Sweepage, and they've got Shulka to help him. There is an option of Sweepage going to ORAS, with Gimmick being benched, and then Gimmick helping the ORAS builders. But ORAS guys with buildings, and giving Sweepage a goal to play in ORAS, and Choka playing black and white, and Choka having help with Sweepage in black and white, or maybe getting spooked, but I don't think that it's going to happen. I think Sweepage will be playing black and white, and he'll support from Alexander, if Alexander isn't doing creepy Italian things by himself. And Shoka. Yeah. Good team for black white, but not too good. They've really only got 2-3 men show, to be honest. So I just contradicted myself. Good, but not so good. Okay. Sweepage will win games if he tries his best and he doesn't cancel out and get a bad attitude. Next off, we got the Sharks. Shark bait. Watch the black white player for the Sharks. And they got Marth. Marth with support from CTC. Case actually knows a bit of black white conflict. If conflict is a bit more agreeable than he, you know, I could see like someone clashing with like Marth in conflict just because they're both strong personalities. But they could be strong personalities that get together very well. So if they hit and they've got good team synergy, which I've heard they have through Case and Hickory. Well, mostly Case. I didn't really spoke to Hickory, but Case seems to like his team, although he's banned now. So I'm gonna take the word for it, and I think they're gonna do well in black white. Marth's determined. Smurf could help out as well, although Smurf sort of only plays offense. Rain with like fucking Jolteon and Weatherless, the fucking Smurf offense archetype, which he popularized. With like Volk, Scizor, Starmie, Dragonite, Garchomp, Lumer. So yeah, that's cool. CTC could help out too, but CTC is inactive and sort of cancerous and sort of builds random ass gay shit, which is not a fan of CTC. Just gonna end this point. Yeah, here. Okay. Raiders. Luck is like, I think Raiders, honestly, like, second weakest team black white behind the Tigers. And then, like, every other team above them is like, I think 1 through 8 is sort of close. And then you get down to 9, 10, sort of drops off a lot. And Raiders, they've got Luck over skill. Ginkgo could help a lot in black white, actually. Cool. Even played a game last year, beat Choka. Martial Law could help out a bit. TDK could help out a bit. But then it just drops off a bit, like a lot bit. Like, Locke is going to be rusty, so Locke's going to need to get the rust off. Genko is going to be a bit rusty himself, too. And Martial Law, I don't know how much he's going to be black-white. The three of them are going to have to combine their minds to prepare teams and shit. And I think it's going to be mostly burn put on Locke. He's starting with Hire. And I don't know if Locke's able to handle that, given his rustiness. And he doesn't really want to play, and he didn't really seem too motivated. I didn't even think he'd want to be picked, to be honest. And he got picked, and now he's in playing this, so yeah. We'll see. Not really high hope. I hope I'll kick his fucking ass week one. Not going to lie. Okay, now we got the Wolf Pack. Wi-Fi Wolf Pack. Wi-Fi Wolf Pack. I don't know why I'm going on. They've got Peachy. I got a fuck ton of support from AIM, Lavos, PDC, Cicada, Undi, Bata, Sugar, Laurel. All could play black and white to some extent. So I think they're going to do well, especially if Peachy tries her best. But if Peachy doesn't assert herself, if she's like sort of turned out by this environment, or she's not really liking the new metagame, or whatever it is, then that's going to be a problem. But if she does, and they all try hard, and they've got a good setting synergy, and I can see the Wolf Pack being very, very successful in this tire. So yeah, good for them. So that's my overall thoughts on black and white. And I'll probably narrate some of my own games, some other black-white games over the course of the season, because yes, I'm going to try to get into that. So you'll be hearing more from me in this tire, and maybe even in ORAS OU, depending on where I go. But anyway, now I'm going to pause it for a second again, and then I'll get back to the ORAS NU. Woo, okay, we are back for the third leg of my three, maybe four if I feel up to it after narrating this part, legged narration cast SPL thingy. Woo, okay, so now we got NU, the tire I played last year, and let's get into it. So first we got Cased. Well, if Cased doesn't get allowed to play, if Cased isn't allowed to play, then the Shark got a bit of an issue. Because he's banned, and they don't really have much backup. They're going to have to put Frizzy in NU, if I had to guess. And Frizzy, not a bad player, but I think he'd probably be 9th or 10th here. He'd probably be 9th, because I'm not really a big fan of Jari, but we'll get into that eventually. Second, we got... Well, oh, let me talk about Case. Case is a very innovative player. He's got a lot of good play in him. Only downside is he could be a bit too creative, in which case, it could backfire. Like, using random ass Mega Audino with like crazy moves, and that could help him as well in the right matchup, but it's sort of situational. Or using like I couldn't come up with many examples off the top of my head, but Case, high risk, high reward player, but his high reward comes out much more often than his high risk. Case plays optimally very often. He doesn't misplay too much, but his builds, they could be very, very good. They could like totally fuck over an opponent. He prepares well. But they could also be a bit of a stretch. They could also be a bit too innovative. Like, just, I call it the Case victory effect. If you use something that looks good on paper, sort of creative, but then it's just like, it doesn't really have much of a practical effect and doesn't work out for you. But I think Case will be serious and will run right things. He's got a good core with Blarigen and shit, but I'll get into that later. Second, I got Teta. He put up the best NU record last year, despite not even starting every week as an annoyer and having a bit of a slow start with 1-2 start until he beat me, and then proceeded to go like 7-2 or 7-3. Lots of respect to Teddy. He's done well in every tournament since then. He did well in NUPL, putting up undefeated record. Him and I were like the core squad in NUPL. We love that team. And he did well last year late in SPL. So yeah, ranked second, justifiably ranked second. Went for 11k, good price for him. Good guy. Doesn't have too much support in NU, not gonna lie, but I think he'll hold his own, especially if he's not rusty. I don't know how he's been playing lately, but I think he's been around. I think I saw a YouTube cast by him, which I referenced earlier. So yeah, he knows his shit. Soulgazer. Very good player. He always puts up a winning record. I have a lot of respect for this guy as a player, actually. I like Soulgazer. He's a good guy. Don't always agree with him or see eye to eye to him. Sometimes it gets a bit interesting, but I like Soulgazer as a guy, a good player. Just to question his ability to build by himself, because Case always says he builds his teams. I don't know if that's just Case being a little douchebag self that he sometimes is, sometimes isn't, besides the point. But if SG could build his own teams, or if SG could get his hand on good teams for his opponents without it, like, compromising his ability to be comfortable with them, and he plays like he normally does, then boom, I think SG's going to do well. I don't think he's going to be a 9-0 player, but I think he'd be a good 6-3, 7-2 player. But he's ranked third because of that question mark, and not ranked first or second because of that question mark. Blast. I like Blast. He's a nice young lad, very cool, cute user. But I don't know how much he's been into the NU tournament scene as of late. I know he's around NU community contributing and shit, but I don't really know. And quite frankly, that's due to my own rust and not lack of knowledge. This is like, if it were another month or two and I didn't follow on you, I probably would like have given up trying to rank the NU players. But I know enough to still rank them besides the bottom one or two, so. Blast, if he plays the level he played last year, is a top five player. He's not going to win every game. He's gonna encounter some rough opponents, especially the ones ranked above him, that are a bit better than him, I feel. But he's good builder, he's good knowledgeable, and he's a good player. That Blast, he's not going to overwhelm you, he's not going to underwhelm you. He's going to perform up the par, which is a bit above average. He'll go 5-4, 6-3. Bold prediction there. He's not going to win less than 5 or more than 6 games if his team plays 9 and he doesn't get hacks of shit. So that's Blast for you. Rose is metaphysical. He's a bit of a risky pick. We spent 10k on him at the bigs. But he's got a lot of support behind him, and he's shown a lot of potential as his build and play. I think he's going to be the next big NU guy. I think he's going to be the next big NU guy, to be honest. He changed his form name to Roses, by the way. But yeah, I think that metaphysical is going to be big. But a lot of guys, like Teda and his cast, thought otherwise. So we'll see. I like him. Just no fucking meme teams, please, dear God. Realistic Waters is next. He did very well in NEPL. He didn't get picked. They didn't play last SPL. I don't quite remember if he signed up or not. But he's certainly on an SPL level. I know that he was hyped up by some guys, and I think that justifiably so. Glad he got picked. Scooters, and he's a middle-range guy. I think he's a step below Blast. I think he'll end up with 4 or 5 wins, but I think he'll be consistent. It's just a matter of him being able to handle this level of play or not. I think he'll be able to beat people below him, especially the last one or two, quite easily. And I think that he's just a good player, good builder, good guy, but not too good. He's got his limits. So, yeah, I'm Canadian's next. Bit of a question mark. He could do very well. He could do very poorly. I just don't know. I think he's a bit more standardized than someone like Metaphysical. But otherwise, he's almost up to his par playing-wise. They are my top two options in the auction because I got to pick the bigs at NU. And I chose Meta over him. And I think that Meta is just a bit more creative and got a bit more pizzazz and the ability to make big plays. While Evan will always be able to make fairly optimal plays, bar maybe once or twice here in the early game. Because I'm not really sure if he could take the pressure of playing in a tournament like this because he hasn't done so yet. But he is able to get the job done for the most part, so 7th is where he resides for now. And if he does better, he could go up, and if he does worse, then he'll go down. It's just that simple. Laurel, first off, I don't know if it's going to be him or Buffalant, whatever the fuck you say it as. Boof, my boy Sarif, playing NU, if it's Boof, then I'm going to rank him one above Canadian Evan, my boy, just because he's solid, he did well in a new open, etc., and he's got some stuff under the sleeve, he's got help from Case, etc., so yeah, but if I'm just going to go with my rankings, just because, yeah, and Laurel is an 8th. Laurel beat my ass a couple times in Smog Tours, he beat others. He's really taken up in you, and he's a very capable player. I'm glad he got picked, because I think a lot of people were unsure if he would. He's a good guy. He's just got to get his act together a bit. When I say a bit, I mean he's got to be stable, like emotionally, physically, mentally. He's got to be able to help his team 100%. And if he's himself, his good self, the good side of himself, because he's a good lad, just with some rough edges, he can do well. He's a capable player. He's top 5 playing-wise. He's just got to get more adjusted to the tire, I feel. So I feel like for an 8, he's a very risky 8. It could be a 10. It could be a 4 or a 3. So yeah, that's just where he fit in. I think that he's just not sure how to rely on him at this point, in you or not. Next up, we have Keo. Keo could be tennis, by the way, just saying. I don't know which one I'm going to pick. Maybe even Hack, but regardless, all 3 of them would rank 9, in my opinion. Keo is just, not that good. He uses sort of gimmicky shit. Not a fan of him. He's not bad. He's got tire knowledge. He's able to play, but he's never really wowed me with his playing. Like, he's never won above and beyond. He's never won exceptionally, won an exceptional amount of games. He's never, been like, oh, this guy's a top NU player. I could definitely see him getting picked in SPL. Like, I'm like, oh, I sort of grouped him in tennis and Shane in the same category going in, and then Shane didn't even get picked. But I think with a bit of help from tennis, if they get along with each other, I think they're going to sort of want each other to lose the other one so they could start. Like if Keo starts, I think tennis might secretly want to lose deep down just so tennis could start himself, and vice versa if tennis starts with Keo. So I think that they might not even get along. I think that might help their week one, week two opponents. But if they do get along, then that could help them boost them up a bit. But I still think that they've got to do a lot of work when it comes to preparation, because these have played in SPL before. And they've got a lot of work to do with overall gameplay, because I feel like both of them are solid, like, ladder players and, like, low-level tournament players, like NEPL maybe. But, like, when you get to SPL, like, it's real big business, like, men, sort of the men's game. And I don't know if they're at that level quite yet. Not going to lie. Not to sort of sound condescending to them. I think they both got potential, but I don't know if either of them's there yet. So that gets them a low rank. And lastly, you got Jari. When this guy's name got picked, I almost spit out my water. I'm not going to lie. I'm not really a fan of him. I think he's sort of newer to any tier. I think that tier, I think Teddy's going to help him out a bit, which is going to help him a lot in terms of accelerating the process. But I still think he's not that good a player. And I think that even if he gets teams or he manages to build teams, I don't know, he's going to struggle to win games. So I'm not really too hyped up for him, not going to lie. But hey, man, prove me wrong. I've heard some bad things about you, but I want to see good. I'm not going to hate on you, man. Prove me wrong. So now let's get into team support. On the Classiest, they have... who's there? They've got... fuck, what's his name? They've got... Soul Gazer, sorry, I saw Soul Gamer. I was like, what? In terms of support, they don't really have much. So yeah, that's about it for support. SG is fine by him own. He'll get help from Case. Ruiners, they have gapped. They've got, fuck, I'm blanking. I'm so sorry, guys. So they have Jari, who I just spoke about. They don't really have much support either, but he's gonna help from Teddy. Maybe someone like Tumu will help him, but Tumu is sort of one-dimensional. I think Kushala only knows RU, and Mazar, mainly is RU-UU, so yeah, that doesn't help him. Who knows, maybe someone like Badass will step up and learn NU and shit. But I don't really have high hope. I think that they're going to end up like 1-8-2-7 sort of with Jari, not going to lie. Bad things waiting to happen. Bigs, we don't have a myriad of NU players, but we do have me, who I'm sort of knowledgeable of the tire. Galbi I can help out. Mental Physical is obviously a player, a middle-of-the-road player at this point, but he's got a lot of potential. And Hansuki is just a sort of god, knows every tire, so you never know. We'll get by in NU, in my opinion. I think we'll win games. But, obviously, I'm biased towards my own team, so that's that. Firebutt Falcons, they have Canadian, and I think Dice likes him according to TRC, so that's cool. I think they've got some good team synergy going. I know Tsung prepared for NU shit for Open. He still knows NU a bit. So he'll be able to help out in NU. Tsung's a really good guy to have on a fucking team. Like, I wish that I had him on my team at some point for World Cup, if he didn't play West, or for SPL, but I don't think that's going to happen. He's going to be a Falcon for a while, and he might be big for a while, so that's that. But yeah, they don't have much NU support outside of that, but we'll see what happens. Scooters. They've got realistic quarters, and not much in terms of NU support at all. Yeah, nope. He'll get by. He'll win some games. He won't do too well, as I said before. Tigers, they've got Tennis. I don't know if Tennis Ace. Ooh, there we go. Yeah, I don't know if Tennis Ace plays NU quite anymore. He used to be an NU guy, and he beat me in one tour way back when, so that's cool. And their player is Blast, obviously. Blast could get help from Llamas if Tennis, if he actually plays. And QSNS, they played NU in a bit. Now Tricking also plays NU. So yeah, they've got their shit together in NU. I respect that core of helpers and player in NU. Okay, Cryos, they've got Teta, and Teta pretty much only. Skyth, I don't think Skyth NU as much. TL6 doesn't NU much, but maybe they can give him a test game or two, that's about it. But yeah, Teta will do fine on his own, and it's an okay NU core. You know, you've got the good player and just not much support, and that's all they need, to be honest, a good player. So the Sharks have Case, and then they've got support of Hickory, they've got support of Blarajan, they've got support of Meru, they've got lower tier gods, to be honest, and then they've got Frizzy, who could, I guess, be the backup NU, especially if Case stand and doesn't let him play. Next off, we have the Raiders. They've got Kyo, Tennis Core, and then Hack could also help out. So, not too good in terms of experience or level of play, playing wise, but they've got three dudes that could do shit. And Hack's probably the best player, but I don't think he's probably the least knowledgeable, so it's just sort of a whammy there. I don't see them doing too well in Indy, not gonna lie. Sort of lackluster core there. And then you got the Wolf Pack, who have Laurel or Boof playing the tire, and they could help each other out too. And then you got like Umfuga, I guess, could help out and shit. So yeah. Respectable, but not too great. So this is going to be near the end of my cast. I'm just going to say that if I had to pick the playoffs right now, I'd pick the Ruiners. In no order, I'd pick the Ruiners, the Bigs, because they're my fucking team, the Raiders, and the fourth team's sort of hard. Let's go with the Falcons. So it'd be Ruiners, Bigs, Falcons, Raiders. And I think that the biggest question mark is the Wolfpack, because I don't know how their lineup's going to look too much, and I don't know how they're going to perform, but they could potentially do well because they've got some nice synergies, they've got some new freshies out there that are probably going to be quite motivated, even if there are a lot of doubters at this point. So don't mark them quite out yet, and I think that a disappointment of a team is going to be the Chronicles, because I'm not really too sure. Vink is a friendly dude, but I don't know how much he's going to be able to handle the management position. Valentine's have a nut job, and then they've got a lot of good players, but not much synergy going besides like Sweepage Soka. And like Logok, Jira, Seaman, and Raka. So yeah, I'm just gonna wonder if they're just sort of gonna click together or not, or they're just gonna be like a team with like three different cliques which don't really work together, and then they're gonna clash and disagree, and then they're gonna crash and burn. Another team I'm sort of questionable about is the Tigers. They've got a lot of players, like as always, every single tennis ace team has, of course. But yeah, they've got some question marks. They've got sort of a bit of a old player fetish for some reason. This is fucking 2009 Frontier lineup right here, guys. And then they've got some question marks and some strong points, but that could turn into weak points with inactivity, so just uncertain there. The rest of the teams are sort of just okay. Like, Classiest are all right. Scooters, maybe a bit better than Classiest, but not too shabby. And Sharks could see good things out of if the team synergy gets going, but if Case is banned, and that sort of is a stinker on him, and I think CTC and Marth and others, I don't really know if the temperaments will hold, even Steven Angelo. So yeah, just an overall synopsis of my thoughts on the teams there. So yeah, a couple of capable teams, couple of incapable teams, couple question mark, couple could be bad, could be good teams. So gonna end it off here. Hope you guys enjoyed. This is Finch. Peace out, dudes.